Hi, I'm Jane Henriksen of Henriksen Talent Management, and you are watching Focus on Management on the VCN.
How did you get involved in the entertainment industry?
I was actually born into this business. My mom is an actor. My uncle's a producer. Both my cousins work in the business. And my mom was a theater actor. And so I literally was raised in the theater. And it's a magical place to be when you're a little kid, to see how a play comes together from scratch all the way to opening night. And initially, I was doing lighting and costuming when I was really young. And that was a very interesting thing for me, and it took me a lot of places. Later, I ended up working in makeup effects and building creatures and creature effects. And I did that for a little while. And I never wanted to be in front of the camera. That's never been something that appealed to me. So I like behind the camera. I like the workings of making things happen. And so when I was in my late 20s, I met and married my now ex-husband, who is actually also a client now, too. And sort of by default, I started managing him because he was the kind of guy that the contract would come and he would just say, where do I sign? And I couldn't stand it. That just so went against my grain. So I said, well, can I have a look? He said, sure, go ahead, take a look. And so I started reading contracts and realizing that I liked reading contracts and that it was interesting to me. And I started finding things that didn't make sense to me. And of course, I don't have a law background, so I wasn't sure if things were wrong. So I would call the agent or the lawyer and say, this doesn't make sense to me. And they'd go, oh, you know, you're right. We got to fix that. Let's go back to producers. So I started sort of by that, just reading the contracts. And then I started fielding the offers and reading the scripts that were coming in for him. And he wanted to go from being sort of the consummate bad guy to being a leading man. And he needed to make changes and make choices in order to make that transition. And I don't know, I just sort of intuitively knew what needed to happen. And so I started sharing my opinion. And so that progressed, and the more we worked together, the better his career was getting, and he ended up getting the leading man roles and then was the lead of a series. And so it was sort of this progression of learning and then, you know, handling all the PR and all of that stuff. And so I was without any background managing. So when we got divorced, I lost my husband and my job on the same day, which was devastating. And so then I did, we have a kid, and I did the PTA mom thing for a while. And then after, three years of that, I got really uncomfortable just doing that. And I thought, what am I good at? And I do have a lot of different skills, but I feel good when I make things happen. And I really, I mean, you can call it codependent, maybe, but I really like helping people a lot, and I like to help people progress. And so it sort of felt like a natural thing to do, and I think I was a little, cavalier, and just thought, yeah, okay, well, I'll just start a management company. And it didn't really occur to me that I had never worked for a management company. I really didn't know any casting directors because almost all the jobs that came in were offers. Most of my experience were with directly with producers and directors, and so right from the gate, it was a major, major steep learning curve. And it's, you know, obviously something just like an actor, a manager or an agent is constantly developing new relationships. So I basically had to start from zero. And I started getting the breakdowns and I started submitting people and I started looking at the materials and having my opinions about how their materials should look and started working with people in that way on a really intricate way. And one of the things that was important to me was to keep my list really small so that I wasn't just sort of a glorified agent and so that I could work on a daily basis, that my clients could call me, they could reach me, they could have access to me, and I could hopefully help them with whatever was going on in addition to helping them, get opportunities to work. So that brought me to where I am today with my own company, and there is that.
How does your industry background inform and help how you relate to and work with your clients?
One of the things I think must be the hardest part of being an actor is being removed from your ability to get work. And I know that one of the things that Breakdown Services has done through Actors Access is give a pathway for actors to begin that process of developing a resume by self-submitting. But the jobs that the actors really want, they're not going to be getting that way. And they need a conduit, and getting an agent is probably the first thing on an actor's mind when they get here to LA or they decide that they're ready to act, they've graduated from college or whatever they've done. So what I try and do as a manager when I do take on a client is I try and keep them sort of on a daily basis aware of what's going on with their career from my standpoint, what projects they're being submitted to, so that they never feel like they're imposing on me when they call. I have heard so many actors say, well, I don't want to bother my agent. I don't want to bother my manager. Well, that's what we're there for, managers more than agents. I mean, what agents and agents used to do two jobs. They did the job of an agent, and they did the job of a manager. But that, with the volume of actors and the volume of projects, that has changed drastically. And most agents don't have time to really chat and connect with their clients. So that for me, I would listen to my mom. I would listen to Lance, my ex-husband, and just going, oh, I never hear from my agent. I never hear from them. And that's got to be just sort of like hanging on a precipice. So I try and be that person. I try and be that person that if there's a question, I find an answer, or if there's a contact that needs to be made, that I try and make that relationship happen. And also, often, because it's just me, I cover the whole town, that an actor will hear about a project through an audition being worked on in class or from a friend. They'll hear about a job that I maybe don't know about yet, or I've seen the breakdown, but it didn't necessarily click for me that would be the right match, and say, can you get me into such and such a project? Now, sometimes I can, and sometimes I can't, but at least my client knows that there's an effort being made in that way to try and I'm usually pretty successful if it's a dead spot on match, getting my client in the door. So the other thing how it helps me is I've spent so much time working with, like I said, my ex-husband, working lines, working on scenes, working on character development. I've sat on set pretty much every day of every shoot that he did. I went to set. I traveled with him. I went to set with him. I sat next to the director. I learned so much about the business. I'm just sitting there with my mouth shut and listening and watching the process. So when my client goes to go work on something, I have a pretty good sense of what they're getting into and what's being expected of them. I have incredible respect for people that act, especially good ones, because I think it might be the hardest thing in the world. And so I try to protect my clients, consequently. I want to make sure that my client's walking into a situation and they're not being treated like a second-class citizen or worked overtime without compensation. Those things are really important to me. And that there's an understanding of the process that they are going through in order to make it believable.
What do you look for in an actor you're interested in representing?
I think the hardest thing for representation is to have what they know is a brilliant actor who has terrible pictures and awful tape. Because from our standpoint, these are our only tools. The business is so fast that people don't, I mean, I'm able to get generals for some people sometimes, and it usually has to do with what's going on, you know, in casting. But for the most part, there's not a lot of generals going on. So the casting director has to take my word for it. But also, they don't want to waste their time. So if my client doesn't have good pictures and they don't have good tape, there's a really, really low chance that I'm going to be able to get them in the door. So, and yet, sometimes if I know that somebody is wonderful, I'll take them on anyway with the understanding that this is, the pictures are first thing, and that as tape comes in, that we go to great lengths to make sure that we capture it and that it's at my disposal. Without those tools, it's super, super challenging. You know, so things that are important to me that, I mean, when I decide to work with somebody, and by the way, I develop people and then I also take on people who've been in the business for a while, and a lot of it is just going on my instinct. I don't usually take on people that just self-submit, but I try and answer to everybody that does. And most of my clients have come to me through word of mouth. The things that make it, the things that will be deal breakers for me are not showing up for auditions, not responding when I call or text, turning down auditions randomly. Of course, I think an actor needs to be able to say, you know what, I don't feel good about that. But I also feel like I have a good sense of what an actor is willing to do and not do before we get started. So if you're uncomfortable with nudity, I'm just not going to submit you to projects with nudity. I just won't do it because I don't want anybody to be in that position. So, and then there's, you know, sometimes it's not magic. There's so many factors. And sometimes it's like a great relationship and things roll and it works and people are getting out. And sometimes, no matter what, even though I believe in the actor and the actor believes in themselves, they provide me with the right materials, sometimes I just can't get that ball rolling. And I wouldn't say it's that they're not good or I'm not good. It just maybe just not a good match or timing or whatever. So I'm always looking to try and advance my people, obviously. If my clients are not working, I'm not making money. But in the same token, I think that there's a lot of things that actors need to do energetically in order to get work. I think they have to be ready to work. I think they have to be ready to accept success. I think they have to walk into those rooms with that kind of dripping with confidence that they're a professional, even if they've only done two things, that they know what they're doing and they can do this, and it's just got to be this, you know.
How do you develop your clients and their careers?
So I think that there are just so many factors about advancing a client's career when they come, especially when they come with no credits. But I think that there's a myriad of things that need to take place. One thing, and these things that I'm going to talk about have to do with what the actor needs to do, because I can't do my job if they're not doing theirs. So the people that I see in my practice that are, whose careers are advancing, what they're doing is that when they are not actively in front of the camera, they are in class. And if they're not in class, they're coaching other people or being coached. And when that's not happening, they're writing materials for themselves, which they can shoot, so they have great tape. And if they're not doing that, they're working out and getting their bodies, because it is, this business is the Olympics. It is the Olympics. And anybody who thinks that it's not, they don't get it. If you, unless you're a character actor, if you want to compete, you have to be in fighting shape. So my clients that are doing those things, they're giving me the tools. So when I call up and I pitch, I am so confident that when they walk in the room, they are going to be a rock star. And part of the thing that I can do when they give me good tape, which they've often had to create for themselves, is I can say, you know what, I've got this guy, I've got this girl, they're amazing. I know you have never heard of them. Please just take a look at a minute's worth of tape. And that, just having, for me to have the same confidence that in my actor, that my actor has in themselves, gives both of us, because now we're working as a team, gives both of us that edge that we need in order to move on to the next level. There's so many disappointments, there's so many heartbreaks, getting on pilots and having them not go, or being recast, or those kind of things. You just have to go, okay, shake it off, moving on. And so those are the things that I think are the most critical about advancing a career. Is this sort of that team effort. And then also, again, like I mentioned before, if a client knows that they're right for something or sees something that they think they're right. Now, I'm not talking about delusional things, because sometimes there's that risk of being a little delusional. But for the most part, I think people have their heads on pretty straight and know what they can do. And so if they say, you know what, I'm right for this, I heard it in class, I'm right for this role, can you get me in? And then because they've been working out, they've been in class, they've been coaching, they've been working, and they've been in front of the camera a lot because they're shooting material with their friends. So when I call and I pitch my client and they walk in dripping with confidence, they've made a new fan. Once you start developing fans with the casting directors, they start calling you in. Oh, what's so-and-so doing right now? Let's see if we can get him in for this role. So it's this sort of constant thing. And actors need to self-promote. They need to be out there. They need to be meeting people. They need to be networking, just like I do. So it's this, and I think the most important thing, again, is work as a team. Your agent, if your agent and your manager work together with you, then there's a way better chance of success.
What are some things that an actor can do to move their career to the next level?
I think the most important thing to start with is to know who and what you are, and to understand the range that you can do and also what your limitations are. And within that, then you have to look at your competition and say, okay, I am in the same category as so-and-so. What do they have going on that I don't? There are obvious things that we have to consider. As good as an actor as anyone is, how marketable are you? And there are small, subtle things that make huge difference. Teeth are a major factor. If your teeth don't look good, that's fine if you're playing a character actor, if you're playing you know, the goofy friend, the next door neighbor, the bum, the biker, you know, you're playing those, you've nurtured that type of a look, and then you're getting those kind of roles. But for the most part, I think people have a different image of themselves and where they would like their career to go. And so you really need to take a look and say, how can I, because to be on film and to be an actor is to be larger than life. It's almost to be a superhuman, right? How can I look at just my aesthetic and adjust it so that I fit that mold a little bit better? So if your teeth are a mess, you got to fix them. If you want to be that leading man, that leading woman series regular, chances are, based on what I'm seeing, you better be in incredible shape. If you're not, chances are, if it's between you and somebody else, and both of you are fantastic, but so-and-so's in better shape, chances are it's going to go to so-and-so. And it's a sad reality that we are so looks-oriented in this business, but it is a visual media. And so consequently, there it is. It is that. Which isn't to say that you have to be skinny or perfect in order to act, but it is to say know what it is that you're bringing to the table and be realistic. And there are always exceptions. There's always the person that's got crooked teeth and or too skinny or whatever, or too big, that becomes successful because they are so charismatic and so confident that they transcend it. But I think that there's, first of all, coming to a place of confidence of who you are and what you bring to the table, and then looking at yourself realistically and saying, what can I change, what can I adjust to make myself more marketable? And then there's always that go to class. I don't care how old you are. I don't care how long you've been doing this. You need to be actively engaged in your craft. Just like ballet dancers, when they're not performing, they're in class. They're rehearsing. If you're not doing it, if you're not taking class and in class and rehearsing, you're not a dancer. If you're not painting, you're not a painter. If you're not writing, you can call yourself a writer, but when was the last time you wrote? If you're not acting, you just want to show up once in a while and do an audition and then, boom, expect yourself to be able to just do it, I think that's unrealistic. So those are the things that I look at with my clients and say, okay. And I advise, I don't have a set list of acting coaches that I say, okay, well, you need to take... In fact, I think if a manager ever says to you, you have to take class with so-and-so, I would go to a different manager. I don't think that that's ever a good thing. I think every actor's got to find their own, the class that's going to resonate for them, that's going to bring out the best in them. And though I might see good people coming out of a certain place, it might be the right place for them. So I think hopefully you have a list of people that you can choose from and audit classes or try them out and see if it works for you and find your way so that when you're walking into those rooms, you feel like you've been given the tools and you're actively engaged in your process. So it's just another audition. It's not precious. No.
How do you, the agent, and the actor work as a team?
Most of the agents, now again, I have a very small roster, so I have time to reach out to the agents that I share clients with. I feel it's very important to have a personal relationship with the agents. Often I'm the one that brings the client to the agent, so I already know them and we already have a good rapport. But I try and bring my clients to agents that I think are a good match for them, that they're the right match for the agency. I mean, I think as you're progressing as an actor, you know, of course, everybody sees these big agencies and they're like, oh, I want to be at CAA. Well, maybe not. Maybe not so much. Maybe that's not the right match for you when you're starting out. And and moving through the ranks. Maybe that's the ultimate goal. But for me, what's more important is that I get, I find an agent who is as enthusiastic about the client as I am. That they, I don't want to have to talk them into it. You know, I might be patient and wait until something happens and then go back to them and say, okay, look, they just booked such and such. Would you take a look at them again if I think that it's the right match? But what I like to do with the agents that I work with is I like to have a, you know, I connect with them like on a weekly basis and see what's going on. Just, you know, sometimes it's just a personal phone call. Just, hey, what's going on? How's your kids? How was your trip? Just so that they keep in mind my client, and also because I like them. You know, there's a lot of very, very cool people in this business. And a lot of the agents that I deal with, I genuinely like. And so when I call them or they call me, that we genuinely, you know, there's that rapport. Also, what's nice with the agents is if we both see a project that our client is right for, that we can double team. So I can shoot an email. So for instance, I can, you know, call Brianna Ansel over at Clear Talent and say, oh, did you see that role? I'm going to call. Did you want to send an email? And if she feels that it's a good match, then she'll respond accordingly and then go ahead and do it so that your face as an actor is being brought up in front of the casting director more than once. Because I think that there's something that happens when you see an actor's face sort of repeatedly. You're like, how do I know that actor? I know that actor. Maybe they just know that actor because the face just keeps, and the name keeps attaching and showing up. So I think that that's, you know, in a nutshell, how I like to work with different agents and my clients. And it's, understand, I mean, it's, I like to think of auditions like this. Think of an hourglass. There's thousands and thousands of pieces of sand in an hourglass. And there's a little bitty hole that they've all got to go through. So when a casting director puts out a breakdown, when you think of all of the managers and all of the agents in this town at the same time converging on that one role, that there could be several thousand submissions for the same part. It's kind of a miracle anytime anybody gets an audition anyway, you know. But if there's a couple people working on it or several people working on it and some of the larger agencies, you know, they all work together. But if there's, you know, a sort of a collective energy trying to push that little piece of sand through so that it gets through the other side. And then there's a better chance of you getting in the door. So that's how I work with the agents that I work with.
What happens when a client books a role?
First of all, the most fun thing about being a manager is calling and saying you booked it. It's like Christmas. I don't care how advanced you are in your career, to get that phone call, you got the job. Out of all those thousands of other people that were up for this job, I can only imagine it's the greatest feeling in the world, because I get it as the greatest feeling in the world. So usually when a client books a role, the agent, if the job comes to me, they tell me about it first, then I'll call the agent and vice versa. And then I say, well, do you want to call or should we get on the phone together? Because it's fun. I mean, this is why we do this. It's so hard, you know? So that's the good part. That's the fun part. That's the frosting. So we both get on the phone and we say, Santino, you booked it. Or Adam, you booked it. Or Camille, you booked it. And then there's that sort of general excitement that takes place. And then usually the agent is the one that the casting directors like. They like to deal more often. They like to deal with the agents, because the agents are the ones that are reviewing the contracts. One of the things you have to understand about managers is there is no industry standard for managers, and I'm sure that you've heard this over and over again, which is problematic. But technically, managers are not supposed to negotiate contracts. They're not supposed to have a hand in negotiating contracts. They're not supposed to have a hand in you procuring work or solicit work on your behalf. But I will tell you this, that if managers followed those rules, managers would be obsolete because they would be useless. But for the most part, the information is dispensed through the agency, or the agency will send out an email and they'll CC me. In the cases of some clients that I have that don't have agents, then the information comes to me and I will give it to them about where and when, and the costume fitting will be on such and such a day, and like that. And then usually once that information has, you know, gone through and everything is negotiated and complete, production just deals with the actor directly for the most part, unless it's a bigger actor, and then it usually goes through me.
At what point should an actor hire a publicist?
Publicity is absolutely crucial to advance your career once you are in a position that outlets will be interested in you. They will be interested in you when you become a series regular. They will be interested in you when you are the lead of features that are more than ultra low budgets. Or if you're working on an ultra low budget that happens to be with an incredible director or an amazing cast. There are those as well. But for the most part, I think that hiring a publicist is very expensive. It ranges from starting at about probably $2,500 a month and up. And some of them are thousands of dollars a month. And they're basically on retainer. So I feel like it's premature to bring one on because, and probably a good publicist wouldn't take you on, unless they feel like they can promote you. The same as an agent, a publicist looks at you and your career and your overall, everything that you have going on to determine whether they feel that they have a case, that they have someone that they're going to be able to get some heat. Publicists that just take you on because you want a publicist, maybe not the best choice. You want to have someone that believes in you. Again, it's like my feeling about picking a agent. I want the publicist that I'm bringing onto the team to be as enthusiastic about my client as the agent is, because it's that type of enthusiasm that's going to sell. But you have to take into this in consideration as well. If you're giving away 10% to your agent and 10% to your manager and another 5% to your lawyer should you need one, and then you're paying another, $3,000, $4,000 a month for a publicist, and this is all before you pay your taxes, the amount of money that you're left with as an actor is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. So there's no point in bringing in a publicist unless your position warrants it. If you're a series lead on a network show, oh yes, absolutely. You cannot depend on the network to, they're going to promote their show, but they're not going to promote you. And the whole point is once you get that series lead or that series regular is you want to promote yourself so that you become recognizable and therefore more marketable, and then you become an offer only actor. And so that's when having a publicist is a useful tool.
What are some of the biggest mistakes actors make?
I would say the thing that will upset me most as a manager is when I call to follow up on if I have convinced a casting director to bring in an actor and I call and they tell me that my client was not prepared. It's inexcusable. Now, obviously, if it's the same day or you get the sides at 10 o'clock at night and the audition is at 10 the next morning, I don't expect you to be off book. But going back to the other conversation about being in class and coaching or coaching with other people, you have to have a network in place so that if you have an audition, even a one that's coming quickly, that you have someone to work with. And so you do go in as prepared as humanly possible for the time given. If you have 3 or 4 days or a week on an audition and you go in and you're not prepared, shame on you and I don't want to work with you. You know, I work every single day. I am not the kind of manager that's out doing lunch and I sit in front of the computer, I make my phone calls, I work really hard, I do my homework, I go through the grids. I'm always looking to be right on top of it for my clients, and I want my clients to be right on top of it. So I would say that is the number one thing. And then the other thing is to go into an audition without a headshot if it requests a headshot, to be late. Now, obviously, we live in LA. Sometimes traffic is horrible, but I'd rather have you sitting there in your car for 45 minutes before an audition than be 10 minutes late. Even though, yes, you often have to sit there for a long time before your turn comes up, still, you shouldn't be the one that's late. I think you mentioned not booking out. Some agents are so uptight about not booking out. They will drop you if you don't book out within 2 weeks before you're leaving. I am not that rigid about it. I do like to know, certainly. I put it in your calendar because it does, I will take that into consideration what I'm submitting you for. And from the standpoint of being from the actor's standpoint, I have been landed in a country when I get a phone call. when I was with my ex-husband, we get the phone call, oh, you have a meeting tomorrow morning, but I'm in Bangkok, you know? So that's always a frustrating one, that some agents will go ahead and submit you anyway with the assumption that you will drop what you're doing or cancel your trip for an audition. I don't think that's a good idea. I'm a strong believer that you have to have a life. Buy a ticket and just leave. Buy a ticket, book out, and just leave. It would be my advice on that, because you have to replenish. Because if you're working as hard as I expect you to work, you definitely need to take time off once in a while to rejuvenate, come to center again. Most actors that on my list are really conscientious, really hardworking, really devoted to their craft. And I don't run into a whole lot of problems with them, thank God. And then there have been clients that have been really super difficult. And we ended up, you know, one thing or another, parting ways and moving on. And good luck to you. And, you know, for the most part, it's been amiable. So.
What is the most important thing for an actor to keep in mind?
I think it's really hard as an actor to know you're right for something and to work really hard and walk into the room and do the audition and kill it. And you walk out and you know you killed it and you felt that energy in the room and you know you killed it, and then you don't hear anything. And you don't hear anything and you call your agent, you call your manager, what happened? I didn't hear anything. And I think that brings doubt in. But so often what I've ended up seeing is the character got cut. They went with the offer. Somebody's producer's aunt is an actor. They decided to change it from a 30-year-old Irish man to a 27-year-old South Pacific girl. The reason why you don't get a job often has nothing to do with you. The producer wants blonde. They don't like that. They want, they, you know, they're just going to go a different way. And I think that the most important thing as an actor is to not take that in or let it cause doubt. Because, again, I think that the most important thing for an actor is to be dripping with confidence. And I don't know how you get that except to do all that stuff that I was talking about before, so you know every time you walk in a room you are on the top of your game. And there's really no, you couldn't have done better. And I don't think it's that important if you mess up your lines. I think that a lot of actors get very stuck on, well, I missed a word. And I think that that's not what casting directors are looking for. If they are, they're not probably really paying attention. Oh, wait, did he just miss a word? Forget it. He's gorgeous. He's perfect. But you know what? He missed that word. I don't think that that's an issue. I think that if you understand the character, if you can bring something different and unique and powerful to the table, then I think that that is way more important than whether you have all of your lines learned. I'm not saying don't learn your lines, but I'm saying don't beat yourself up if you messed up a line. I also think, and I don't know this to be true for sure with every casting director, but I think that most casting directors, if you feel like you have gone off track, will allow you to say, you know what, let me just go again. Not 27 times, but I think that they will give you the grace of going again if you need to. And I think, again, it's walking into that room with enough confidence to say, I need to start again. Yeah. So, yeah, that was the other important thing I wanted to say.